Good morning. I'm Bobby Robbins, president of the University of Arizona. It's hard to imagine how we'll come out of this current global epidemic, but I'm here to tell you we absolutely will come out of it. Things will never be exactly the way they were, and hopefully that includes positive changes, especially in regard to all of us leading healthier lifestyles. Today, I'm joined by Dr. Andrew Weil, founder and director of the Andrew Weil Center Integrative Medicine at the University of Arizona. Andy, good morning. How are you today?
Good morning, Bobby. I'm good.
Good. Well, Andy is really the father of integrative medicine globally. And before I came here, I spent over 20 years at Stanford, and I had studied all of Andy's work, and I was so honored to finally meet him and have just enjoyed the 3 years that I've gotten to be a colleague with him. We've done some fun things, and this includes doing this interview today. So it's an honor to have you here today, Andy. And I think everybody's wondering, and I'll just say for myself, this has given me a time to be reflective about my own health. As you know, you and I both go out to a lot of dinners every night in our official capacities. And probably I had not been taking as good a care of myself physically as I should have been. So I think that it would be helpful as I've really focused in on what you've been teaching all of us for years and years about the proper nutrition and proper exercise that we should be doing. And luckily, over the last month, I've been able to do that myself and have been encouraging others to do it. But what can you recommend as far as lifestyle strategies to optimize specifically in this day and age our resistance to infection and for the future? Because this won't be the last pandemic we face.
You know, the main thrust of integrative medicine is to emphasize the organism's innate healing potential. And we really prioritize health promotion and disease prevention. One of the principles that I've seen over and over again in my career is that healthy organisms are naturally resistant to infection and disease. And I've seen this in plants, I've seen it in animals, I see it in people. One example from my botanical studies, I once saw a field of soybeans that was divided in half, and one half had all the nutrients that the soybeans required. The other half was nutrient deficient. They were predatory insects that were decimating the nutrient-deprived plants. The well-nourished plants were relatively untouched. So you see the same principle generally in biology. So our best defense against infection, including pandemic infections, is to maintain optimum health. So we know the main lifestyle factors that are important there. It's good nutrition. It's getting adequate rest and sleep, getting regular, moderate physical activity. I think something that's often not given much due is our mental emotional states. We know that stress impairs immunity, that the main stress hormone cortisol is directly suppressive of immune function. There's very interesting research that laughter actually increases immune function. I'm delighted. One of the things that's happened in the past few weeks is that people are sending me funny videos and stories. I think that's terrific. So I think these are all, you know, basic lifestyle strategies, in addition to all of the practical advice that we've been given about social distancing and cleanliness.
Yeah. Well, I think your soybean analogy gets me into the next thing I wanted you to discuss with us. For instance, a balanced diet is very important. I, of course, am trying to focus on carbohydrate intake because I am a carbohydrate junkie. Bread is my vice, Andy, as you well know. But what about some of the natural remedies that may be helpful to augment some of these public health measures like isolation and social distancing and of course washing hands?
First of all, I think vitamin D is strongly protective, and we know that it has a protective against influenza, for example. In fact, one theory why influenza is a winter disease, it's when people are vitamin D deficient. So it's good to get your vitamin D levels checked and to be taking supplemental vitamin D. I think it's good to take a mix of antioxidants, especially if you're not eating the vegetables, a variety of vegetables that we're told to be eating. I recommend an herb called astragalus. It's a Chinese root that's been used for centuries to ward off colds and flus. It's very safe in long-term use, and it modulates immune function and increases resistance to viral infections. A very safe thing to use.
How do we get that root, Andy? Do we just eat the root raw? Or?
You can. It tastes good, and it's cooked in soups in China. But you can buy capsules of standardized extract. You can get it on Amazon, have it delivered to your house. But that's a good one to have on hand. Turmeric, the yellow spice. This, I think, is also another very useful preventive and interferes with viral entry into cells. As does green tea. So these are some things that you can use. Now, I would not rely on these in order to prevent you from getting COVID-19 infection, but they're helpful.
Yeah, I think the vitamin D thing is obviously very important. It can also be important because I actually had, as I'm getting older and exercising less, now I'm trying to exercise more. But certainly we get risk of having low vitamin D levels and the risk of osteoporosis, in addition to the beneficial effects against infection. So, how can we reduce our risk for future and potentially even worse? I know it's unimaginable that we could think of a pandemic being worse than this, but as you and I well know, it could be a lot worse.
You know, and I'm sorry to say, I think it will be a lot worse. We're certain to have more and worse pandemics. Infectious disease experts have been warning about this for years. I have to say here that I think there's been a colossal failure of leadership in this country. You know, we had, not only were these warnings being given to us for years, but we had months to see what was happening in China, and we were really caught with our pants down. Now, the factors, these are zoonotic diseases, that is, diseases that are jumping from animals into people. You know, there are bacterial diseases as well, but the real concerns are viral diseases. There was AIDS, SARS, MERS, these various hemorrhagic fevers, which fortunately have been mostly local so far.
Right.
Why is this happening? And the factors, I'm afraid, are all human caused. It's our activity which is making this happen. It's overpopulation, too many of us, too dense population, no people concentrated in dense cities. It's encroaching on habitats of animals, deforestation, climate change. All of these factors are favoring these spillovers of zoonotic diseases. And the likelihood is that there will be more pandemics, and the potential is for much worse ones. You know, this is not the next big one that people have been talking about. That, you know, the 1918 flu, that was a big one. A much higher mortality, a much higher infectivity, and it killed a lot of people. So something like that could easily happen again. I think influenza is probably the most likely one to do that because that has such a potential to mutate. So I think we really have to look at these, you know, of these factors that I mentioned, what are ones that we can do anything about? You know, you look at one thing that I would look at is our dependence on animals for food and our farming practices. If people would eat more plant-forward diets, if we raised fewer animals for foods, if we did not have these concentrated animal feedlots, that would be helpful. Also, if you begin eating lower on the food chain, you are dramatically reducing carbon dioxide and methane in the atmosphere, which is one of the drivers of climate change that's favoring all this. So to me, this is a big issue of public health. And as you know, there's a natural marriage between integrative medicine and public health. And this is an area I'd love to see us focus on, of like what we can do to change some of the human behaviors that are driving the evolution of pathogens in these bad directions.
Yeah, well, Andy, you know, I have tremendous respect for you and your great wisdom and what you've done for the University of Arizona. the United States and truly the world. You're a globally recognized leader, and people listen to what you say, either through your books or your lectures or things like this. So I know how busy you are, and I really appreciate you making the time to do this video with me. It's always great to see you. I just wish we were at one of our local favorite restaurants having together. And soon enough,
one day we will.
Soon enough, we'll be back together. But I just really appreciate all the time you gave us today, and thank you for making the time to shoot this video.
I enjoyed it.
All right. Well, thank you, Dr. Andrew Weil. Tune in next time. I'll be back soon with yet another great leader. Probably not many that we could go that are more important, more globally impactful than Dr. Weil. So, Andy, again, thank you very much. But again, everyone, stay tuned. We'll continue to bring helpful hints to you about how we're going to get through the current state that we're in. I'm very confident of that. We're going to get out of this one. But as Andy said, I think this is our wake-up call. Exactly. To be prepared for the next really big one, not only in terms of public health issues, but also stockpiling of resources that we'll need to treat whatever's around the corner. But until then, all of you, please, out there, stay safe. And as always, bear down.